Good afternoon. Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon, sir.
Well, one of the biggest challenges that people who speak is to speak after the afternoon session. So obviously, I'm going to do my best to not let you sleep. I'm going to share some incidents from my life. I'm going to talk about challenges. I'm going to talk about setbacks. I'm going to talk about how our challenges and our setbacks make us who we are, define our life, define our destiny. To begin with, why am I speaking about this? What is my personal experience in this field? I passed out of school, did my graduation. When I was at the end of my graduation, my whole family belongs to army. So of course, the next choice was natural. Go into army, be a soldier. And that's when, at age 21, I was in boxing, I was involved in NCC, I was involved in all kind of physical activities which would have prepared me for a life in army. At age 21, I had a medical problem. One fine evening, I experienced my first seizure, taken to hospital. Once I went out of home, it took me almost 1.5 months to return back home. The only difference that I went back full, but when I came back, I was half paralyzed. They said because of boxing, there were certain knots which developed inside my head. And because of that, half of my body went limp. So all of my left part I could not use. I literally had to learn everything again, including walking. Even small functions like getting up from your bed and do the small chores that you do, like using the washroom. It wasn't easy for me back then. And it took me 3 years to recover from it fully. So I'm going to talk about setbacks. We all have our own destinies, our own journeys. We design our journeys. And as Navjot Sidhu said once in one of his talks, life is what happens while we are making other plans. And it had happened to me. When you meet a setback, the first thing that hits you is, why did it happen to me? I believe one of our speakers were talking about it. Why me? What did I deserve to have this? I was in hospital in PGI, which is not far from here, I believe. I was here for almost a month. And I'll tell you, when you reach your first setback, what happens? First thing is fear that strikes you immediately. I'm suffering from something. I've already caught something, some ailment. How long is it going to take for me to recover from this? Am I ever going to recover from this? Second part. And all of these things just cloud your mind. These anxiety, this lack of surety. I remember asking my doctor when he came to me. I was in emergency and the doctor came and saw me. I was lying there with my stiff neck and without half of a body which couldn't work. And the doctor came to me and he talked to me, any questions, young man, after he had seen me. And I told him. And out of hope, I believe, back at that time, I asked him, when am I going to run again? And he said, let us worry about you walking first. Once you start walking, we'll see to it that when are you going to run. It's not easy. Trust me. Keep that faith going. Fear, anxiety, how long is it going to take? All my friends are studying. All my friends are taking courses. All my friends are moving on. My life is stuck. I'm not moving. I'm stuck here on the hospital bed. I don't want to be here. And then the last part, which is the most damaging to any person's self-belief, self-image, that is pity, self-pity. I remember one day, against all the doctor's wishes, I ventured out. I wanted to see if I could still walk. I could not. And that's when, after about walking 10 meters, I stopped. I sat on the stairs. And I cried. For someone like me, who had been in boxing preparing for army, tears are not something that we value. For the first time in my life, I was pitying myself. I was not really proud of myself. I could not even walk 10 steps. Now this is the time. Now these situations, I wish to God that none of you ever have to go through any of these kind of experiences ever again. Or ever rather. What I'm trying to say through this is, whenever you are making a plan, there is someone else who disposes all these plans. And it's quite possible that you will hit some setbacks. There will be some obstacles along your path. what to do, how to keep your self-confidence going, how to keep yourself motivated, how to keep moving on. Now this is what I'm going to talk about here and today in this talk. First and foremost, the belief in your own capabilities, the belief that everything is going to be fine someday. It is very, very important. And I'll start with the first thing. There are three things: passion, patience. Passion and patience are going to take you along the journey of recovery, and not just recovery, maybe you are going to get better than what you were ever before. And the third point, which is equally important, is perseverance. I will start with my first story. The story was told to me by one of my friends during the time when I asked my doctor that when was I going to get better? When was I going to run again? The first story includes, we have been told that the ancestors of human beings were monkeys. We have evolved from monkeys and now we are human beings. One question was asked from me, that what have we learned during all this time? I could not answer it. I did answer a few things, but those were abstract. And then I was told a story. Once there were a few monkeys. They went to some village, some city, some orchard, took some fruits from there, plucked some fruits, broke some branches, and then the gardener came there, chased them away, hurled abuses, threw stones on them. Now all these monkeys had a meeting in the evening. They were all very worried. They were talking amongst themselves and they were talking that our respect in the society is falling. People don't respect us anymore. There was a time they would worship us and now they are throwing stones at us, hurling abuses. This is unacceptable. What should we do to rectify the situation? And then there was one old monkey who stood up from the crowd and he said, if you are going to, of course, damage people's crops, you are going to get all of this. Then they asked him, what is the way out? And then the old monkey says, okay, fine. What if you can plant your own trees? And someday you will have your own trees. The trees will bear fruit. You can pluck fruits from there. And then you don't have to listen to other people saying bad things about you. No one is going to pelt stones on you. Monkeys are very happy. Okay, fine. Tell us the process. How do we do it? How is it possible for us to have trees growing? He told them, okay, fine. We will take the good tree and we will take it. We will dig a hole, put it inside, put some minerals, some water, conditions favorable, tree will come out and someday it will bear fruits and then you can have your own fruits. So the monkeys, everyone is very happy. Next morning everyone gets lots of good leaves, gets together in the ground, and then they have dug their holes, put the good leaves in, put some bath money into it, and then they are waiting. But monkeys are not known for waiting. So monkeys, after every 2 minutes, are digging the hole once again, trying to find out where the tree has gone. And needless to say, with this attitude, you can tell how long it would have taken for this orchard to grow. The orchard was never there and the monkeys are still in the same predicament, how to earn respect in the society, are we? So I was told that the first lesson that we learn from anything is patience. Be patient. Listen to the advice. Take control of the situation. Get all your facts straight. What are the things that you need to learn? What are the things you need to know about the predicament, the problem that you are in currently? In my case, it was the doctors. I needed to listen to the doctors. There were medications, there was diet plan, and all of those things. There are things which I could have done. There were things I was told not to do. And you listen to them and you follow those things religiously. This is the first step. Second step, when we are on recovery, at times we get a little impatient once again. We want the results very fast. After all, we have evolved from monkeys, right? The apes have been our ancestors. So after a short while, once again, whenever I will go to Chandigarh, I will come to Chandigarh rather, and talk to my doctors and talk to them that the recovery is too slow. I want to recover fast. I have so many things to do. My friends are already way ahead. And that is when I got to know this another story which told me that it's important. It's important to persevere. Keep your passion going. Remember where you are headed, but then you need to be patient with it and you need to persevere. I'm reminded of, we were talking about perseverance, Florence Chadwick. I don't know, many of you might not have known her. She was a very good swimmer. She was in USA and she was trying to, at the age of 34 in 1952, she was trying to cross Catalina. There is a channel called Catalina. She was trying to cross it. She would have been the first woman in the world to have done so. Now while she was attempting it, the weather conditions were not very good. The weather conditions were bad. The water was icy cold. All the currents and tides were against her. and to make matters worse, the waters were shark infested. But the lady had courage, determination. She had her goal clear. She started. July 4th morning she started. She went through the channel. She kept on swimming. The only problem that day was that the frog did not lift. The fog did not lift, rather. There was intense fog there and the visibility was very, very low. She could not have seen where she was going, she was headed. So there was a support boat in which her trainer and her mother were accompanying her just to keep her safe, not to get her inside the boat though. So they were giving instructions and she was moving on and there were shots being fired to scare the sharks which were approaching that particular area. Now Catalina Channel is 21 miles wide. It's not a short channel. She kept on, hour after hour, she just kept on struggling, moving on. At 15 hours, when she was swimming for 15 hours, that's when she started having doubts. That's when she started having doubts whether she will be able to reach the shore or not. And at 15 hours, 55 minutes, she abandoned the attempt. She told them that now I'm going to get back into the boat and I don't think I can do it. And when she came back from there, to her surprise and shock, she was told that she was less than a mile away from the shore. She would have created history that day. Same happens to many of us. When we are very close to success, when we are very close to the next milestone, we give up. It's like a combination lock. We have got four figures right, which are just fiddling with the fifth one. And any moment we can get it, and that's when we decide to give up. So don't give up. Persevere. You might not have gotten what you have longed to get. You might not have yet received the rewards you have set out to get. But persevere with it. You will surely get it. You will get there. Moving on. Our mythology is rife with examples. And my two favorite examples that I have taken from mythology are Karna and Bali. I don't know how many of you have heard about them. But Karna was supposedly the best archer in the world in Mahabharata. And in Ramayana, we come across a character named Bali. Bali who had this vardhan that whenever he is going to fight someone, half of the power of this other person is going to come into him. So he will be fighting with more power than the other person, of course. Whenever we are faced with situations, such situations where we are facing problems in our lives, most of the time, most of us choose to become Karna. Now why being Karna is not a good thing in this case? Because Karna had a shrap, had a bane, that whenever he is going to require his education the most, he is going to forget all of it. And that is what happened to him in Mahabharata, and that's why Arjun could kill him. But think of the other thing, other possibility. When the power is in your hands to choose, when you are the one who can choose whether to feel empowered or limited, whether to have empowering belief or a limiting belief, the remote is in your hand. You are the one who is making that choice. Can we be Karna or do we have to be Bali? I'll give you an example, a very small example. I'm going for an exam. I'm just asking you as a question. When we go for the exams, what are we focused on most of the time? The questions that we have completed or the part that we have left? Most of the time in our minds, we keep thinking about the things that we have not prepared well. And this is how we bring ourselves into a very limited and an unresourceful state of being. And that is why when you start from there, most of the time many people have experienced this, I don't know if you have had it or not, that during the exam you come across questions and then you think to yourself, I knew this question, I had done this question, I don't know why I'm not able to do it right now. Have you ever had that experience? Any of you? And there is something else to it. As soon as we step out of the examination hall, what happens? Oh my God, exactly the point. Yes, I am reminded of the answer. Now this is what happens when we are not in a very resourceful state. This is how we deprive ourselves of the knowledge that has already been stored inside. It's a wonderful computer, might not be the latest one, not better than the uploads or like they said, the latest versions, but it is still a good one. Moving on. Now we are talking about faith. Having faith in this middle period while you are recovering from your setbacks is very, very important. I talked about the Chadwick story for the same thing. You cannot see the shore, believe it is there. Believe it is there, keep striving and you will reach it. Sooner or later you are going to reach it. I'm going to tell you another small, very small story. I wonder why God puts us through all these tests. Why couldn't God just have allowed me to be healthy in my life, allowed me to get what I wanted in the first place? Why should I have had to struggle during all these years? Why would He want me to go through all these struggles? And then I was reading once, and then I was going through the Bible. I was reading a few areas of the Bible, some chapters, some verses from the Bible, and I came to know that actually God's Son Himself had suffered much more than me. He allowed His own Son to suffer. Then I believe whatever has happened to me is actually quite less. So if you want to make a comparison, I would rather not be Jesus and be Sunil Verma and have a small setback and still have the strength and by His guidance and by His blessings still move on in my life. But there was this very small story. They say that there is a bamboo tree in China. It's called the Mozo bamboo tree. I don't know how many of you have heard of it. They say it's a bamboo tree. When you plant it under ideal conditions, this plant, there is nothing above the surface for the first 5 years. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Nothing above the surface. But in the fifth year, something magical happens. In the fifth year, suddenly you see that the bamboo tree starts growing. And it grows at almost 3 feet per day. The speed is such, almost 3 feet per day. And within the next six weeks, this tree reaches at full height of 90 to 100 feet. Now my question, what I'm trying to say here is, when you are working hard and things are still not working out for you, have that faith going. Mozo bamboo tree, the growth is just because of the fact that during those first 5 years, the bamboo tree has actually had miles of roots to support that vertical growth later on. Right now, when you are striving, struggling, God is making you strong. God is giving you all the skills and perseverance that you will require for the growth in your life later on. So, stick with your situation. Welcome the confusion also at times, which is bound to come. Confusion is important because confusion is going to enlighten you later on. You stay with your confusion. You are not getting your answers. You are asking the right questions. I was told once that when Newton was sitting under a tree, there was an apple which fell on his head. I'm sure when the apple fell on his head, it did not come down with the gravity theory written on it. Did it? It did. And Newton was thinking. He was asking the right questions. He stayed with the doubt. Why did this happen? Why did it not go up? What's the reason some things fall down very fast and some things come down very slow? What's the relation in all these things? His confusion led to him for his research first, and later on his research was rewarded with the discovery of gravity or acceleration due to gravity. You stay with your confusion and your confusion will be rewarded very soon. Now, as children who are supposed to be the leaders for tomorrow. I was amazed at looking at the children, making all the arrangements here also, and I would like to compliment the school on it. I believe in a school, there have been questions raised since morning. I was talking and I was, that in the very first presentation, Mr. Rodriguez, he questioned all of the knowledge that we have. He said that it might not be true. And then Mr. Tully started and he also talked about education being off mark at some extent. I believe school is a replica of the society itself. This is where we have people from all backgrounds. This is where we tell them that following the rules rewards you. Not following the rules will land you in some kind of trouble. There might be consequences leading out from it. And this is where it is very important for every single one of us to learn that how to coexist in society with people who are not exactly like us, with people who are different than us in various ways. How to have that harmonious coexistence with all these people. And that is why it is very, very important, the roles that the schools are playing in creating the leaders for tomorrow. Because the schools are not just creating. Now, if you are having this doubt that schools teach us the class 10, 11, 12 syllabus, they're not just teaching you class 10, 11, 12 syllabus. They are preparing you for life, life beyond school. This is where you learn those lessons. And believe you me, when you go out of these walls, when you step out of your schools, these things will not be taught. These things are taught at school, where you are told the value of the importance of kindness, the values, the morals, the ethics that you need to learn for the rest of your life. Of course, you will learn many things. We don't stop learning, but formally, this is where it is taught. to the children. You being the leaders of tomorrow, I believe on your journeys, that the journeys that you are going to embark upon very soon, you are also going to face some setbacks. And that is why I'm narrating my story today. I'm talking about myself, that how I made a few mistakes, how I learned from my mistakes, and maybe someday my mistakes and the stories that I'm telling along with it will help you some. While you are growing, do not ever ask, do not ever be afraid of the challenges that you are going to face in your life afterwards. I'm reminded of the famous quote of Marianne Williamson. My biggest fear, our biggest fear, is not that we are weak. Our biggest fear is that we are powerful beyond imagination. Our light, not our darkness, is what makes us afraid. We ask ourselves, who are we to be talented, fabulous, gorgeous? And then she answers, who are we not to be? We are the children of God. Believe that God has made you in His own mold. He has given you all the capabilities you require to lead a successful, rewarding life, enriching life. You believe in yourself, you move on with confidence, take everything in your stride, and the world is never going to be the same just because you came this way. You can make that change. In the morning, Mr. Rodriguez was talking about changing the world. Right now, we heard Mr. Sudhanshu talking about changing the world. He is making his own contribution. I believe that's a very nice initiative, and not many people have thought about it, and he has raised very valid questions. I hope some of you, and most of you, actually do follow whatever he is trying to do. This is how we create leaders for tomorrow. But then, knowing your responsibility has some duties also. Now, this is the part we are not very happy about most of the time. It has some duties also. I believe you have been taught well at school. Your teachers have given you all the values necessary for the life beyond the school. But then all of this is not complete when we talk about facing challenges, keeping our faith going, and persevering, and patience and passion all joined together. There is one more angle to it that I found out at the stage when I could not do what I was supposed to do. When I was facing my challenge, medically challenged, that's when I realized the importance of family. Most of us do not talk about it. We love our parents, okay, fine. But then how important the family is to you? It is during those times of crisis that we realize the real importance. When I was sick, my parents were always around me. And one day I was walking. I was told by the doctors not to walk, but being, I told you, evolution. I was moving in a hall, trying once again to check whether I have recovered my strength or not, in the leg or not. I was moving in the hall. My father told me, where are you going? I just made some excuse, lame excuse of sorts, and I moved on. And while I was moving on, someone who was in a rush must have brushed past me and pushed me inadvertently. And I was falling back, and that is when for the first time I realized that while I was out on these secret walks, my father was always walking behind me, and he was right there. Catch me before I could fall to the floor. Children, your parents care for you. They love you. A family is a small circle of trust. Family is a small circle of trust. Whenever you are facing challenges and setbacks in life, they are the ones who are going to revitalize you, give you the strength required. One small story, and I'm going to end my talk with it. One morning I was sitting in the balcony. I come from Solan. I was sitting in the balcony and there are nice pine trees out there. And there are two big monkeys. It was raining in the morning, very pleasant weather, but it was raining, it was very cold. There were these two monkeys sitting out on a branch and they were hugging. And the first thought that came to my mind was romantic monkeys, So enjoying the pleasant weather. And after the rain subsided, after a little while the rain subsided, and these two monkeys, they got away, and I saw that they were carrying a little one between them. And they were trying to shield that small baby monkey between the two of them. They were trying to brave all the weather conditions, the intense cold and the rain, and they were trying to save that baby. There are no lengths to which a parent won't go to keep his child safe and to make him prosper in life. Always trust your family. That is the small circle of trust that we all have. do your best. Your parents will always be with you. And I always firmly believe that whatever we do in our lives, I do talk to my parents about all the achievements that I've made, however small they may be. And I ensure that they get to know that whatever advancements I'm making in my profession. So, love your parents, trust them. Whenever you need them, they're always there for assistance. We have seen lots of things on television. You are being told about it. Where children at times become experimental. Trust your parents the most. They are the ones who really care for you and who have made many sacrifices for you. The last part without which I won't end. My favorite John Wooden quote, it's a verse from Bible. John Wooden says, a poor man at God's footstool to confess, a poor man knelt and cried, I've failed. A man goes to the church, confess, at God's footstool to confess, a poor man knelt, I have failed, he cried. The master said, thou didst thy best, and that is success. So I wish you do your best, and if you do your best, with the blessing of your parents and the God Almighty, you will get your dreams. Do not worry about the setbacks. Even if you face more setbacks in life, do remember this once again, the same sequence. Take stock of the situation, keep your passion, perseverance and patience going. Have faith, persevere, take advice from your parents. They are the best guides you've got. Thank you very much.